away. So please, once again, stand to your feet. Let's welcome the man of God for this hour, my dad, Pastor Philip Durbin, as he comes. Woo!
Wow, look at you tonight. Y'all look rich. It's just a joy to, do that. You got to do something back there. Help me out. So I'm not tunneled. It's a joy when you find your tribe, your extended family. And, you know, me and Mama Alberta were, you know, we go to a lot of places, but I understand we're all in the family of God. I understand that doctrinally, theologically. But then there's some like precious faith, right? There's some like precious faith. And when you find it, it's precious. It's precious. And this came out prophetically Friday night there in Frankfort, and it just leaped up inside of me again. Ain't nothing gonna stop you now. If I had some people that really believed that tonight, ain't nothing gonna stop you now. No. What hindered you before? What delayed you before? What brought you to a standstill before? Ain't nothing gonna stop you now. Did you hear what? Come here. Come here. Raise your hands. Nothing gonna stop you now. Come here. Lift your hands to heaven. I don't know who you are, but I'm here to tell you, God's got a major assignment for you. Nothing gonna stop you now. Good God Almighty. Mokababasa. Horababakata. Hey, baby. Stand up. Stand up. Stand up. Come on. Come with me. Come with me. Come with me. Makababababase. Lift him up. Lift him up. Lift him up. Lift him up. Horababababase. Bebebebebebokoto. Lift him up higher. Lift him up higher. Lift him up higher. Yeah. Strengthen your body. What the enemy meant for evil, God's gonna turn it around for good. Come on, one hand. One hand, come on. Woo! You keep walking in that. You keep walking in that renewed strength. Lift your hands to heaven. Power on him, Lord, in the name of Jesus. From the top of his head to the soles of his feet, in the mighty name of Jesus. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Oh! The end of a thing is better than the beginning. Strong. Strong. I wish somebody give God praise in here. Harabakaya! TJ, come here. Lift your hands to heaven. I see a breakout. Power on you, Jesus. Boy, I tell you, the Holy Ghost in this place. Morababa, you come here. Come here. Mate, esta, robo, kata. Lift your hands to heaven. That which has been lacking, that which you've desired, that's what's been held back. You better get ready. Power is coming to you. Masto la 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 basa. Hey, bebe, beke. Morabaka. All three of you, come here. Come here. Mostande. Mikarata. Come on, right here. Right here. Lift your hands to heaven. Oh, my. Wisdom beyond your years. Power on you. Power on you. Power on you. Makoto hasto tabase. Meke bebondo. Ribe. Masto la rabasa. You, come here. You, right there. Mato bese. Meke. Mato la rabaka. Oh, you want this? You want this? Power on you, Jesus' name. Makabase. Me brebe boko. Motalarabasa. Oh, Jesus. Jesus. Somebody help me praise the Lord in here. Maloro bokoya. Me brebe boboto. Oh, rabababake. Oh, my love. You right there. Right there, you. Yes, you. Come here. Run up here. My Lord Abase. Mebebe kebebe babakata. Moto babakaya. If you're a visitor tonight, we just want to welcome you to Exceeding Grace Church. We're just having church. But I got to loosen up early here. Goodness, y'all feel that going on in here? Hallelujah. You're going to be glad you stayed with it and who you stayed with. Yeah. What are you laughing about? Come here. Lift your hands to heaven. You're going to look good in it, man. You're going to look good. Power on you, Jesus' name. I used to hate my job when I was in the world. But I like my job in God. Woo! On you in Jesus' name. Leviticus 18. Them some good looking shoes, man. They don't make him in white, do they? Chapter 18 of Leviticus. Let's do a little quick review. Review is?
Preview.
Real quick like, because we got a lot of places to go tonight. Well, why don't you just prophesy over all of us? I am right here with the word. Ain't going to do no good for me just be throwing power around and you not know how it works. Woo! Leviticus. Come here. If you feel that, lift your hands heaven. I see an avalanche about to cover your life. Power on them. Man, I just saw that thing. I just saw it cover them. You'd be doing that too. Yeah. I ain't sweating or nothing, but I just see Pastor Jonathan do this from time to time. I figure it's white ones for me or something. Oh, y'all quit now. Woo. I ain't getting no power nap. Y'all got power naps. Napping for the power. Leviticus 18. And it says here in verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Pastor Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, the congregation, saying unto them, I am the Lord your God. After the doings of the land of Egypt, wherein you dwelt, shall you not do. And after the doings of the land of promise, the land of Canaan, where I'm bringing you, shall you not do. He cuts off every avenue of you and I doing something. He said in verse 4, you shall do what I tell you to do. You should do my judgments. So this thing about going from the land of not enough over into the land of more than enough is not something that you're just going to do because you're smart. Because you're a hard worker. Now praise God that you're smart. Praise God you're a hard worker. But your smarts and hard works is never going to give you the lifestyle that God has for you. Let me remind you that in the land of not enough, remember this, land of not enough, God has to send you a revelation to bring you out. He used Moses to bring a revelation to these people in bondage that they could come out. It was impossible for them to come out. For 400 years they'd been in bondage, living a life of not enough. But God sends a man of God to them with a revelation. That revelation brought them out into the wilderness, the land of just enough. Land of just enough. They had manna every day, right? Just living from miracle to miracle. The Bible doesn't say the just shall live by miracles. It says the just shall live by faith. Now, when you live by faith, you're going to experience miracles. But not always living a life in need of a bailout. And so right in here, in the land of just enough, God doesn't want you just to have a revelation. He wants you to have a relationship. God wants you to know who He is. A revelation of what He said will bring you out. But He wants to now establish a relationship here. Because if you're just a revelator, and not somebody that has a personal relationship with God, where He's taking you, you're going to get in trouble. Because you're just a revelator. So right here in the land of just enough, He wants to develop a relationship. Right? But to go into the land of more than enough requires something beyond a revelation, something in addition to a relationship, and it's called responsibility. You have to be responsible over here. And the only way you're ever going to be responsible to operate in that kind of supernatural increase in power is to have a relationship with God. Now let's back it all the way up over here again. So what God does, He sends a man of God into your situation with a revelation, and you in this situation have to trust the man of God. I know there's men of God that can't be trusted. I know a few. But that don't make all of them bad. And right here, you don't really know much about God anyways. So you got to trust the man of God in the revelation He's bringing to you. when you come over here in the land of just enough to trust God. Trust the man of God. Now, trust God. But this is the key. When you go over into the land of more than enough, not only is it a place of responsibility, this is the place where can God trust you. Can God trust you? Can He trust you with extreme wealth? See? And so we cannot do what we were doing when He brought us out, and we cannot do what they're doing, the world, when He brings us in. So that's why we got to be doers of the word. See? And so we've been looking at Deuteronomy. That's just too long. We got to get in this thing. I can get carried away here. Deuteronomy chapter 8. I'm just going to go straight to that verse. Verse 17. And you shall say in your heart, my power and the might of my hand hath gotten me this wealth. But you shall remember the Lord thy God, for it is He that giveth thee power to get wealth. God gives you power to get. He gives you power to get. And we discovered that God gives you power to become rich. You're supposed to be rich. It's not just, you know, see, the body of Christ is so mixed up when it comes to the benefit package of God. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, and forget not His, who daily loads us with benefits. We have a benefit package. Now, hey, we don't make light that our sins are forgiven. We're born again. We're new creations. We're on our way to heaven. We don't make light of that. But this verse is what jerked me around years ago in Romans 8:32, how God spared not His own Son, how shall He not with Him freely give us all things? See? And I thought to myself, my goodness, they didn't tell me that in the United Methodist Church. They didn't tell United Methodist. They didn't teach me that. And I love the Methodists. They might not claim me, but I'm a charismatic Methodist now. Amen. But here we see that God gives you power to get well. Go to Ecclesiastes. Let's look at that once more. Ecclesiastes chapter 5. And then we'll get into this thing tonight. I'm happy already. Ecclesiastes 5, verse 18. Behold, that which I have seen, it is good and comely for one to eat and to drink, and to enjoy the good of all his labor that he taketh under the sun all the days of his life, which God gives him, for it is his portion. Every man also to whom God hath given riches and wealth and hath given him power to eat thereof and to take his portion and to rejoice in his labor, this is the what? The gift of God. David said it this way. He's prepared a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Right? So right here, we see that God gives this. But just because it's been given, we live in a present evil world. A Babylonian system. The power of Satan to get wealth. We looked at earlier this morning. Right? And so because we live in this kind of cursed environment, we have to go against the grain. We got to go upstream. Any old dead fish can float downstream. It takes a live one. I was talking to this 91-year-old fella on the plane coming down here, and he's a fisherman. My goodness, sharp in his mind, sharp in his mind. He's telling me about salmon. And salmon, something unique about salmon. My goodness, I think I've shared that here before, but it just comes up, so I say it again. There's something inside a salmon, fish, that when it comes time for multiplication, it goes against all odds. Have you ever seen that on TV when them salmon are going upstream? Oh, they see a cliff and they don't stop, and they just keep flopping up there and flopping up there until finally they get there. Then they got some bears over it trying to grab them. But there's something inside of them that says, I can't multiply where I'm at. I got to get higher. I got to go to a place. Come on, somebody. And they are determined to get there. Come on. Ain't nothing going to stop you now. Well, I'm feeling that thing tonight. See? Well, there's something inside of you greater than inside of a salmon. Called your divine nature. Right? That when you start hearing truth preached under the anointing, all of a sudden you sit there and think, why sit we here till we die? What? What? I've been lied to. I've been cheated. See, and God begins to move. God begins to turn things around in your soul. And all of a sudden you start seeing, my goodness, wait a minute. I'm supposed to multiply. I'm supposed to increase. Right? And so, woo! God puts this thing out there in front of his man. But it's not automatic. He has to give you power to get your portion. We see it right here in chapter 6. There is an evil which I've seen, verse 1, under the sun, and is common among men. A man to whom God has given riches, wealth, and honor, so that he wanted nothing for his soul of all that he desires, yet God giveth him not power to eat thereof, but a stranger eats it. What's she doing eating my portion? I mean, you go into a fine restaurant. You order you a nice steak filet mignon, you know, just a baked potato with butter just oozing out of it. A nice salad. Toasted bread. Nice glass of San Pellegrino with lime, fresh lime. I'm talking about one that you squeeze and it squirts all over the table. My goodness, not that dry stuff. And all of a sudden, you go to the bathroom, and you come back, What you doing eating my stuff? Now see, in the love of Christ, you going to let this person know you're at the wrong table? Well, what are we doing? What are we doing? Folks, by the time Tuesday night gets here, you're going to be cranking in some power. I'm telling you. You'll be cranking in some power. Right here, God has a table prepared before us in the presence of His enemies, but it takes power. It takes power to be able to eat of it. And God gives us power to get well. Now, Proverbs chapter 10. What you doing sitting there cutting my steak up, medium rare, you stranger? Get out of here. You devourer. You devourer. You tired of the devil eating your stuff? Your portion? I got tired of it. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22. Y'all know it well here. The blessing of the Lord, it makes rich. It makes rich. What's the it? The blessing. So God's not contradicting Himself. He's letting us know what the power is. That the blessing of the Lord is the power to get wealth. It makes rich. And He adds no sorrow with it. So the blessing is the power of God to get wealth. Now we're going to get into the blessing ingredients now, right? And as we go through these four, I've got to get two in you tonight, hopefully. We go through these four main ingredients. We're going to make us a blessing cake. Yeah. All these ingredients you're well aware of. See, somebody can give you a recipe, and you can sit there and say, well, I got all that stuff in my house. Yeah, but if you don't know how to put it all together. If you don't know how to mix this and that together, even though you got the ingredients in your house, ain't no cake being made. Now, I brought out this morning how somebody got a recipe, a secret recipe. They'll take all the compliments. What you got in that thing? Oh, you know, some herbs, some spices, little something mama showed me. Right? You can go online, all that, try to figure out what it is, you know, and all that. But there ain't nothing like something that's been passed down generation after generation after generation, right? Well, I'm telling you, this blessing has been passed down generation after generation after generation after generation, and you in 2015 are about to hear the ingredients that make up the blessing, which is the power to get wealth. So, our first ingredient, Ecclesiastes. You already got these ingredients in this house. I know what's preached here, but we're going to mix them all together. Have you ever been over somebody's house and you're in somebody else's house, but you're helping them get a meal together, you know, and the thing that you brought, you know, you're going to make it right there, and you say to them, hey, do you have any this and that, you know, and they say, oh, yeah, I got it right here. You know what you're after. You know what you're after, right? Well, it was in their house. But you knew what you were after. And listen, you got to have a mixing bowl. You got to bring all this stuff and put it together. Follow this. You're going to find out what Pastor Jonathan and Pastor Kim's been teaching you all this time. You got all the ingredients in this house. Now, Pastor Philip going to come in here and just mix it all together. And you're going to come out of here with power to get wealth.
Hallelujah.
Ecclesiastes chapter 8. Look at this. Verse 4, my favorite verse in the Bible right here. Where the word of a king is, there is what? Here is your base ingredient. We could call it flour. You know what I'm saying? Whatever you want, your cake mix or whatever you want. This is your substance that everything else that you bring into is going to cling to. It's going to be mixed in, right? The Word of God. See, a lot of Christians aren't being taught the Word of God. And so they hear about prosperity. And they even tithe for a month. To see if they were going to be kept from being kicked out of their house. And it didn't work. Why? Because they didn't have no Word. Listen, everything God does, including the blessing, starts with the Word of God. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God, right? Right? Matter of fact, let's look at that. John chapter 1. John chapter 1. Verse 1, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Verse 12, but as many as received the Word. Him is Jesus, the Word. But as many as received the Word, to them gave he to what? To become the sons of God. Look, you ain't a son of God, bro. You a child of God, but you ain't a son of God. You have to become a son. Are you following? A son is someone that has matured. A daughter is someone that has matured in the things of God, not a child. Well, I'm just a child of God. Well, then stay a child of God if that's what you want to do. But don't get mad at us. Don't get mad at the pastor because he got 3 cars. Well, I don't think he needs 3 cars. Well, there's somebody don't think you need 3 pair of shoes. Well, he ain't. What do you need 3 cars for? What do you need 3 pair of shoes for? Well, I need 1 pair to go to work. I need 1 pair to come to church. I need 1 pair to go jogging in. There's somebody on this planet don't think you need 3 pair of shoes to go where you're going. Boy, I don't know where y'all come from. That's Sunday night crowd. Y'all can handle that. Sunday night crowd. Glory be to God. Come on now. Because if you choking at that, we ain't going to get very far. As many as received the word, to them gave he power to become. Power to become sons. Power to become. So what happens is the word, our main ingredient, the flower of the blessing, God wants you to become something. So he brings you a word and expects you and I to grow up. How many of you know the word will make you grow up? Oh, it will. It'll sit there and say, why are you acting like a kid there? Why are you acting all childish there? Why? You know the word will do that. It's the Lord that worketh in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure, work out your own salvation, right? So right here, this the word, the power of it, begins to change you. And all of a sudden, you become, before all this really changes out here, it becomes you in here. Come on, we're going somewhere with this. And so inside, you become a son, a rich son, a rich daughter. Before you see it out here, it don't take long for that to happen, by the way. It don't take long for that to happen. That's how powerful. Doesn't Hebrews 4:12 tell us that? The word is quick and powerful. Right? So, God knows the power in his word. That's why he says, it will not return unto me void, but it will accomplish that thing whereunto I sent it. It will prosper into the thing where I sent it. Come on now. Right? So the word, we know the word's powerful. Right? And so that's why every time you come in here, Pastor Jonathan ain't preaching out of a Reader's Digest. He giving you the Greek and the Hebrew and my goodness. Come on now. He's giving you, we got flour going every which way. You ever see kids getting a flour fight in the kitchen? Flour just going every which way. Right? Right? And that word is doing what it's designed to do. It's causing you to become. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creation, new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. It's a becoming new process. And how it becomes new is by the flower, the word of God, the bread of life, the flower. Are you following this? Okay. Now, over here in Ephesians, while you're turning there, the Apostle Paul said in the letter to the saints at Rome, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. For it's the what?
Power.
What?
Power.
Don't be afraid of that word. It's what?
Power.
Power of God. It's the power of God. See, there's a lot of people that are ashamed of the blessing. They kind of hide it. They try to hide what God's doing. No, don't hide nothing. Flaunt that stuff, man. I ain't talking about look what I got and you ain't. I'm talking about just bless God. Let people see what the Lord has done. Hallelujah. Now, in Ephesians chapter 1, look what it says here in verse 16. I cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him. In the knowledge of Him. See, when Adam fell in the garden, he went from the wisdom, discerning, downloading level to the knowledge of the tree of good and evil. He fell from just discerning and downloading anything he'd ever need to know down to the knowledge level. And this world ain't never got past it. Ain't never got past knowledge. That's why they'll teach you to get over here, get you student loans, get you degrees. We'll give you power to get wealth. Now, I'm not against degrees if God's called you there. But if it's just a carrot out in front of you, come on, somebody. We got a young man in our church, my goodness, 18 years old, and wants to go to college, and he feels like God's called him to be involved with all these reptiles and things. I sat him down. I said, come here. And by the time he done talking, I said, yeah, I look like God. That's what God wants you to do. I said, I don't want to do that. 18 years old. Had his first car given to him debt free. 18 years old. Son of a single mama. Been raised in our church. Come on now. Gets a full paid scholarship to college. Right there. Come on now. All 4 years. And they've given him some grant money for whatever reason. He didn't apply for it. They just given it to him. And he getting a check every month, driving his debt-free car, going to 4 years of college because God is doing something in him. One of the number one, the feds own the student loans now. Man, it's done surpassed the credit cards. Why? Because it's a carrot out in front of you, man. If ever I'm going to get out of the land of not enough, over in the land of more than enough, I got to have me an education. I'm not against education. Come on now, I am not against education. I'm against debt. And if in your education you get so educated that you don't need to acknowledge God in all your ways so He can direct your path, you in trouble. Come on now. I'm preaching better than y'all shouting. I know too many people got trapped in student loans. I got people in my church. Got people right here, I guess. God can cancel student debts just like He can any other debt. Same power. Why? Oh, yeah. I got reading the books, what started all that. Verse 16, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of Him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. That's what's happening to you right now. That you may know what is the hope of His calling, and what the riches of the glory of His inheritance in the saints. That's what your pastor been teaching you. Now watch this. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward? Who what? Who believe according to the working of his mighty power. Now see, we shout about that. Yes, amen. Resurrection, life, power. Wonderful. But that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened, so that you understand what you've been called to. Riches, the inheritance, this power to usward who believe. There's a power. Got it all set before you. But one person, he gives power to eat. Another person, he don't get no power to eat. I'm talking about Christians. I ain't talking about Christian sinner. Look like sinner been eating real good out here. Come on now. We're talking about Christian. One has power to eat, take his portion, even though both of them is a gift from God. But there's something. You got to have these ingredients. God ain't going to sit there and make you rich and you goofy. You're going to be out there doing goofy things all in the name of the Lord. Come on now. So that the word creates power within you to become on the inside what God wants to manifest and you live in on the outside. And to get to that, the eyes of your understanding to be enlightened. See, the world out there chasing all kinds of enlightenment. They're chasing all kinds of enlightenment. They look into the guru, the psychic, spirit guide, stars. It's crazy out there, right? Christians too. See, I remember one time we were in Jamaica on vacation, and before we left, Alberta grabbed me and she said, "Promise me you're not going to preach." I said, "Honey, promise me you're not going to preach." "Okay, I'm not going to preach. I'm not going to preach. Vacation." Well, because we've been going and going and going and going. And God had given us a vacation to Jamaica. So we go to this nice resort. And, you know, all inclusive, you know, and we inclusiving. And one evening we're partaking, and our table was outside right there, in nice landscape, manicured resort, you know, there in Jamaica. And all of a sudden this guy comes around, and he sets up a table right there. Now we're up here, we're up high, probably 3 or 4 foot up in the air on this patio. Fenced-in patio and foliage all around. And he comes over and he sets up a little table down here on the sidewalk down there. And it's right there where I'm sitting there. And my meal right there. And he sets up right there. I look over there. He got his little tarot cards and all this stuff, you know. And a crystal ball. And I'm like, something happens in a true prophet of God, right? And they're lined up. They're waiting in line for him to read the palm, look in the crystal ball, and I'm sitting there, and Alberta says, because she can see too, she said, "Honey, I'm over here." I said, yeah, babe. "Well, you devil from hell, I bind you. Honey, I said, "Huh, I gotta go down there. I gotta go down there and let this guy read my palm." Should I stop? She said, "You promised me you wouldn't preach." I ain't gonna preach. I'm gonna let him read my palm, and I'm gonna read his mail. She threw herself. Philip, don't do it. Don't do it. So we left the table. I'm walking down there. She's right there. She's jerking me. And finally she runs and gets in front of me. She said, "Philip, did God tell you to do that?" Now see, why'd she have to say that? Man, we gonna have us a time, Brother Tony. I'm about to rock that resort like they ain't never seen. Why did you have to say that? I said, "No, the Lord didn't say that, but come on, we can't let this go on." She said, "No, did he tell you to?" So I just walked by him and I just glared at him, just hoping he'd look at me. He knew the anointing walking by. Because when I walked by, he stopped what he was doing, just looked up at me. They know. Right? Power. Isn't that something? That heathen out there that tap into that know more about the man of God walking by? Come on now. Than Christians do. I'm not even talking about y'all. You know. What is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe? So we see that the main ingredient, the flower of the blessing power, if you will, is the word of God. Do we have that ingredient in the house? Do we have it in the house in abundance? So we ought to be able to make a big cake in here. Not little cupcakes. Right? Because of the word that's coming out here. I'm telling you folks, you ought to thank God you in this place in these last days. Not everybody hearing this stuff. See, if all Pastor Jonathan and Pastor Kim wanted to do was build a mega church, then just get off the word. Have a little cocktail bar in a foyer out there. Start at 11, out at 12. Don't teach on tithing and giving, you know, make people laugh, you know, and tell them it's all good and everything's fine. Man, we'll pack this place out. Ain't nobody gonna learn nothing. But boy, we'll be right in there look what God's done. And God didn't do none of it. Come on now. So the main ingredient, flour, the word. Now, let's get to the second ingredient. Are you ready for it? Proverbs 18. You got all these ingredients in the house. It's not like I'm going to bring an ingredient up and like, "What's that?" You know, where do we get that at? You know, we just had John Paul and Mercy Paul at our house, and she just cooked us Indian food. Oh, Jesus. shrimp curry, crab and eggplant, mango salad. But before she cooked it, she asked us what we had in the house, and we didn't have in the house what she needed to make that thing. Because, we ain't got nothing in the house to make anything. What are you talking? Ain't no cooking going on in our house, Brother Tony. Ain't no cooking. We can make shakes. We can make shakes. It's true. She asked, did we have any, what was it, tamaric? Is that how you say it?
Yes,
turmeric. Turmeric. I said, tumor what? We got salt and pepper. Sea salt. Garlic salt. We ain't got no turmeric. So because we didn't have that, we could never make what she was about to make. Folks, understand what I'm trying to tell you. All the ingredients to the blessing, the power to get wealth, you already have in the pantry, in this house, in abundance. We are just going to mix them all together. You're going to say, is that all there is to it? But see, you bring somebody in out of mainstream religion, they don't know them ingredients. They're going to be like, what? They don't understand that. They understand theology, maybe. They understand, jokes. Jokes. That one preacher said, I just like to start every sermon with a joke. You are a joke. You do start every sermon with a joke. You start it, you end it, you are. If you're not preaching God's word, you got people coming in there, and you sitting there, I'm going to start. Hey, there ain't no joking matter out there. When you sitting there, and the devil's got your stuff, and you sitting there coming into the word of God to hear from the man of God, and he says, and when he living in all that, I just want to start with a joke. So don't think I'm just saying that, just be saying that. There's some things that ain't funny. Come live where I live and see if that joke works. See, I needed something that's going to rock my world. Come on. I come out of 14-year drug addiction, alcoholism, locked up 20 times, looking at 21 years in the penitentiary, right? Y'all, I am home. Yeah. So when I come into this thing, hey, I'm all in. And 28 years later, we're walking in it. Are we in the fullness? No, but I'll tell you what, our tank ain't empty. Let me say it this way, our tanks aren't empty. Aren't you tired of empty? Empty gas tank, empty refrigerator, empty bank account, empty this, empty that. Are you kidding me? Empty. The 11th commandment. Thou shalt not lack. Ain't nothing going to stop you now. Proverbs 18:21. Say hallelujah when you're there. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the harvest, the fruit thereof. All right, here we go with another power. Here we are with another power. We already found out the word power. Now we're seeing the tongue power. This is where you add your sugar, your flavoring to your flour. I mean, if you just bake a cake and you ain't got some sugar in there, come on. I mean, if you're going to eat a piece of cake, load it up. Oh, don't look at me like y'all don't know what sugar is down here. Y'all know what sugar is. That's what some folk call it. He got sugar. Talking about diabetes, you got sugar. Right? I was raised with sugar. See, we ain't getting no candy growing up. My mom was a baker though. And we did get sugar. We had a sugar bowl. Anybody remember the sugar bowl? They still have sugar bowls these days, sugar bowl. Right? So when it was cereal day, I mean, we took spoonfuls of sugar. By the time you ate all the cereal and drank the milk, you had a bunch of sugar in a bun. We didn't need no Cocoa Puffs. We didn't need no Frosted Mini Wheats. We didn't need all that stuff. Mama always bought puff wheat and corn flakes, but boy, we had the sugar. Mama would say, "That's enough sugar." Woo! So, the tongue likes some flavor. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Come on now. So our second ingredient is your tongue with power. Your tongue with power. Now you better follow this one, because this is where I want to spend the remainder of our time here on this second ingredient. Because a lot of people they miss it right here. The Bible plainly declares that death and life are in the power of the tongue. And it doesn't stop there. It says blessing and cursing are in the power of your tongue. Go with me to James. Say, we know where we're going. Yeah, because you got the ingredients in the house. Why do you think Pastor tells you you can't talk like that? You can't be going around saying this is killing me. You can't be talking like the world. I ain't talking about just stop cussing. I'm talking about you can't be talking all this death talk, all this negative stuff. You can't be saying, well, you know, that person's just a pain in the neck. You can't be talking that. Scared me to death. You can't be talking all that and be operating in the blessing that maketh rich. It fights each other. See? The last thing you want to do, how many of you know sugar and salt look the same? Rabakaya. And you're going to go put a cup of sugar in, it's a cup of salt. Oh, man, you got that thing frosted. You got that thing cut up, put on a plate, big scoops of ice cream with it. And all of a sudden, what? What? Right? That's what James is talking about over here. James chapter 3. My God. This is your flavoring ingredient, your sugar ingredient, your tongue. You want the flavor that you like. See, watch this. We say it like this. My wife, the way she dresses, some people, they look at her and say, wow, she has good taste. Do you understand that? Ain't nobody over licking on her. No, no, no. We're talking about good taste. It's what she likes. It's how she presents herself. It's how she sees herself decorated by her master. You understand? Good taste. Come on now. Now, what tastes good to her? It's not for everybody. Are you following this? That's why when we went in the restaurant last night, we all didn't order the same thing. Except for the chicken wings. Oh, Lord have mercy. Man, we had bones flying, TJ. The bones just flying. Lord have mercy. I like eating with Kim. I do. Because we both just team up and don't listen to what Mom's saying. Hallelujah. Even though we know what Mom's saying is right. But now watch this, watch this, watch this now. What tastes good to you might not taste good to someone else. Right? It's according to, and see, God knows the desires. He knows your needs and your wants. He knows what you like. That's why when he does something, I mean, he signs his name to it. I mean, you're like, God, you're just too good. You knew that I liked that, and you not only did that, you did exceeding abundantly above all I could ask or think. According to the power that works in us, right? Right. Right. And so this blessing that makes rich, the second ingredient is your tongue. Now look at here, James chapter 3, my goodness. Look what it says here. Oh, man. Well, verse 1, chapter 3, right? My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. In other words, that's telling you don't get your faith out there in 100 different directions and you ain't mastered none of them. Then you're going to sit there and be preaching against the preachers that preach it, saying that stuff don't work. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a matured man, a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. Now see, that's talking our language in Kentucky. Bridle. Come on now. And he says, behold, verse 3, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may
obey.
You better understand that if we can just get something in the mouth, if we can just get something in that massive mouth of that horse, it has to obey us. Ain't no man any match physically, strength-wise, to a horse, right? But we put a bit in their mouth. You know, in Kentucky, when I was a heathen, I went to a lot of horse shows, and those horse shows, it's remarkable what they can do with those horses. It is just, I mean, they're telling. They tell them to back up, and that horse will back up. They tell them to kneel, that horse will kneel. I'm talking about by voice command now. They went from just a bridle, pulling this way and that way and making it turn, to, hey, you're going to get even more sensitive than that. Yeah. You're going to get where I don't even have to put any effort into it. All I have to do is say it. Come on now. Following this. Well, watch this. Behold, we put bits in the horse's mouth that they may obey us, and we do what?
Turn about their whole body.
Turnabout. A turnaround. The whole thing turn around. Instead of going in the direction that wild horse wants to go into, it now has to obey us and go in the direction we want it to. Are you ready for that wild horse of financial debt and your abundance that's just out there on the open plain? Are you ready to rope that horse in and get a bit in its mouth and break it and get on board and ride this thing and have a turnaround in your life? Somebody shout in here. Get out of full gallop. He's liking that to our tongue. And he goes on to say this. Behold also the ships, which though they be so great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about. Now we got a horse turning about. We got a ship turning about. But it's turned about with a very small helm. Now getting back to the bit ain't that big. Ain't that big. And the helm on the ship is not that big. But yet it'll turn around a massive horse and a massive ship. Right? Now watch this. Behold also ships which though they be great and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with a very small helm, whithersoever the governor list. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm the governor of my ship. Now, hey, I've preached this here before, but it bears repeating. When that governor says, I mean, on the surface, fierce winds, it's making it go in a direction you don't want to go to, right? But the governor said, no, I ain't going that way. I don't care what the winds are blowing. I'm turning this thing. And watch this. He makes the selection. Turns. And where you can't see in the unseen realm, a direction has been selected. Even though the momentum of that ship and the wind carries it a little further in the unseen realm. There's been a direction selected and given a certain amount of time. It's going to begin to turn that whole ship around. Ain't nothing going to stop you now. Nothing. Nothing. Nothing going to stop you now. Hey! God don't forget nothing. But you can't be flipping off with the mouth. Because he talks about a horse, he talks about a ship, and he brings us right to us. He talks about a bit, he talks about a helm, and he talks about this tongue. Even so, the tongue is a little member. And does what? I'm a millionaire. Yeah, boasting great things. I'm debt free, living in abundance. Yeah, great things. Big things. And you should be confessing that. You should be declaring that. But you can't mix salt and sugar in your cake. You ain't hearing nothing new tonight. But we mixing it all in one bowl. And you're going to see how close you've been all this time. Come on now. Even so, the tongue is a little member, boasts great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members that it defileth the whole body. Your tongue. You keep speaking, you getting old. You keep speaking, well, my memory ain't like it used to be. You keep speaking all that kind of stuff. You're defiling your whole body. Your body responds and says, okay, let's go into breakdown mode. Let's go in the cursing mode. See? It defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature and is set on the fire of hell. For every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of who? Isn't that something? Man can take a fierce tiger, stick his head inside it. Stick his head inside it and everyone say, whoa! I wouldn't stick my head inside that tiger's mouth. Got him tamed. Got him trained. Come on now. Isn't that something? That man can tame every kind of wild beast, every kind of whatever, whatever, however out there. I had a friend that had a pond in his backyard, a 1-acre pond, and he had fish trained. He called them by name. He said, now watch this. Watch this, Philip. And he said, now this fish I'm calling right up here, he's got one eye. His name's One Eye Jack. Now watch this. I'm serious. I got this on film somewhere. And he holding a minnow up. He said, come here, Jack. Come here, Jack. Come here, Jack. And we're out there on the dock, you know, and here all of a sudden this fish comes up, one eye. And it jumps out of water, grabs that minnow out of his hand, and go back in. A fish responded. That's the kind of power that has been given man. Oh, I know we're ending up here. I got to get there. Look what it says. But the tongue can no man tame. I can't tame Pastor Jonathan's tongue. I can't say, hey, no, we don't talk like that. In other words, it doesn't mean your tongue can't be tamed. It means I can't tame it for another person. And that person can't tame it in themselves without God. That's why the psalmist says, set a watch over my mouth. Right? I want conviction if I speak anything contrary to my blessing, to my prosperous life. God, you quicken me. Don't let me go a minute. Don't let me, sure enough, don't let me go a week, a month. Are you following this thing? Well, just sometimes I just get so frustrated because, of this. I just got to tell somebody, and then they just made me mad. Grow up. Look, you can either vent your feelings for the moment and rob your future, or you can, in the name that's above every name, glory. I'm talking about inside you. In Jesus' name, Tabasco sauce, you get back down there. No, that's not worth my harvest. That's not worth everything I've sowed for, praised for, fasted for, prayed for. No. I'm overcoming evil with love. Hallelujah. Come on now. And you keep everything in line, your future's not been messed with. In a negative way. See? You're taught that here. The ingredients are in the house. We mix them all together. You can't leave out one of these main ingredients and walk in the blessing power. You can't do it. Oh, you might get something here and there. But I'm talking about the blessing that maketh rich. Right? All right, now watch this. But the tongue, verse 8, can no man tame. It is unruly, evil, full of what? Man, what does poison do? Kills. The tongue. The untamed tongue will do only one thing, kill. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. So when life is in the power of the tongue, there has to be something tamed. Something has to be reined in. Verse 9, therewith bless we God, even the Father. We come in here, praise the Lord. And therewith curse we the boss man. Which are made after the similitude of God. I said boss man there, you know. It says, therewith curse we men. Which are made after similitude of God, out of the same mouth, same mouth, proceedeth what? Okay, now watch, we're talking about the blessing that maketh rich. We're talking about the blessing power. I don't let just anybody pray for me. No. I don't care who you say you are or who said you were that. You're laying your hands on me. Come on now. I don't know. I don't know where you just come from. I don't know what you've been saying. Oh, you might be saying all this here in front of me, prophesying all that in front of me, but, I don't know what you've been cursing back there. Come on now. out of the same mouth. Look at this. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things, what things? Blessing and cursing come out of the same mouth. These things ought not so to be. Does a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can we answer that?
No.
Can the fig tree, my brethren, bear olive berries? Either vine, figs, so can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh. Who is a wise man and endued with knowledge among you? Let him show out of a good conversation his works with meekness of wisdom. So, got a glass of fresh water here. Glass of salt water here. If I take this fresh water and pour a little bit in that salt water, still salt water. If I take a little bit of this salt water and pour it into the fresh water, huh? It's the little foxes that spoil the vine. When the grapes are tender in the vine, when it's harvest time, you think the little things you flipped off here and flipped off there, it messes with the blessing. It messes with the blessing. You ought to thank God for the gift of repentance. Hallelujah. Don't listen to that mess out there. The gift of repentance. My goodness. That's how restoration operates, the five steps to restoration. First one is remorse. The second one is repent. The third one is refreshing. The fourth one is renewal. And the fifth one is restoration. You remorse. You're sorry. Then you repent. Then there's a refreshing that comes from, oh, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. But then you got to get rid of the issue that caused the problem. You got to get your mind renewed. And restoration follows. See? The gift of repentance. Now I know about, I was raised in Methodist Church. We repented every other service. Because Jesus was coming at midnight and you was going to live the rest of your life in hell where there was no water. Come on now. And, just in case. We repented again. We wasn't repenting. We just going through motion. You understand what I'm saying? Do we see that words that we speak, the tongue, has power? So you have power to bless your children. You have power to bless your checkbook. Bless that car. God will get you where you're going, but in the meantime, bless that car. Don't curse it. Don't be sitting there saying, that old raggedy thing and kicking up. Bless it. I said, bless it. See? We had a car. I tell you what, that thing, my goodness. It must come out of hell. And it seemed like every time I turned around, that thing and the engine was messing up in it. Me and Alberta took a prayer cloth. We blessed that thing. I went out, lifted the hood up, Pastor Jonathan, lifted the hood up. And where the reservoir was, I unscrewed it, put that prayer cloth in, screwed it back down, that thing kept on running. We blessed it. Now, praise God, we don't have to do that with the vehicles we got now. But the power to bless is in your tongue. That's one of the ingredients. It's the flavor. Are you following this? All right. Let me get over here to where I need to go. I got so much stuff here. But Hebrews. Let me take you two more places. Can I? Hebrews chapter 4. I done got hungry. 10 more minutes, right? Are y'all receiving anything tonight? Hebrews chapter 4. Are you there? Verse number 1. Let us therefore fear. I ain't talking about the spirit of fear. It's talking about the fear of the Lord. Let us therefore fear lest the promise being left us of entering into his rest, into what God has for you, any of you should seem to come what? Oh, my goodness. I had enough coming short in my finances. Short. Then you got to make that phone call. You got to go talk, work out something with the landlord and all that, you know, all that. Well, I'm a little short. God never intended for us to be short. But he tells you how you end up short. Right? For unto us, verse 2, was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not what? Did not profit them, not being what? Mixed. All right, we already got faith in the boat. Now we're putting the sugar in. We got to mix it. Come on now. This is your mixer. Your tongue is the mixer. So you got two groups of people here. Both of them heard the gospel. Preached to them. But the word preached did not profit them. And he tells why. They didn't mix faith with what they heard. And you can't mix faith without using your tongue. I know there's other things to go with faith. Yeah, action and so on and so forth. But right here. Now, I said all that to take us to Ecclesiastes chapter 10. Look at your neighbor and say, 5 more minutes. Maybe. Ecclesiastes, right after the book of Proverbs. My favorite book in the book that I love. Ecclesiastes. Are you there?
Yes, sir.
Verse number 19. A feast is made for laughter, and wine makes merry, but money. Money. Does your Bible say money? What? Money. So it just ain't mine. It ain't just this Kentucky Bible. You'll say money. M-O-N-E-Y. Your Bible say money. How many of you in here, your Bible says money? Oh, my goodness. But money answers all things. Now watch this. You can take that verse, and this is true. A feast is made for laughter, and wine makes merry. In other words, just a good meal, sit-down meal. And money, something's got to pay for that. Right? 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 But you want to go off the high dive?
Yeah, come on!
Watch this. Watch this. Back up to verse 16. Woe to thee, O land, when your king, brother, is a child. Now let's just personalize that. Woe to you, your land, when you as a king are still a child. Anybody catching that? Are we not kings and priests?
Yes, we are.
Woe to thee, O land, when your king, and your land is your portion. Woe to thee, O land, when your king is a child, and your princes eat in the morning. In other words, the first thing they think about is when they get up is their belly. They don't think about God. They think about just whatever they desire, and that's how they're going to spend their day. You know, the first thing that comes into your mind when you wake up is the most important thing in your life. And I can remember when I'd wake up, I'd be woke up by debt. Screaming from the other room. Bill. On the kitchen table. We're not paid. Back in those, I didn't have to ask anybody. What day is it? I could tell you. It's the 15th, or it's the 30th. I didn't have to ask anybody what day it was. But see, when you're deaf, you don't even keep up with that, man. What's today's date? The 8th, see? I don't keep up with that. But there was a time where I knew exactly what day it was. I knew what hour it was. What time the bank closed? Run a check down there to catch a check. Watch this now. Woe to thee, O land, when thy king is a child, and your princes eat in the morning. Blessed! Now remember I was talking about woe this morning? When God says woe, it ain't good. Woe ain't good. When it talks about the woes in the tribulation time, it ain't good. But it says, blessed are you, O land, when your king is a what? When he finally went from being a child to be a son. Come on now. Come on. Come on. Come on, kings. Come on, kings. Kings take dominion. See, we're kings and priests. Priests minister unto the Lord. Priests go in there and they minister unto the Lord. That's what priests. But when you come out of that, kings come out to dominate. To command. Priests go in there and worship the commander and find out what it is the command is, and then turn around, royal priesthood, and come out and start commanding things. Children don't command nothing. I mean, you know, they might try to tell you, but they don't command nothing. They might act like they're gonna do all that, or you know, try to do that, but they don't last long. Right? Right? Watch this now. Woe to thee, O land, when your king is a child, and your princes eat in the morning. Blessed are you, O land, when your king is the son of nobles, and the princes eat in what? Let me help you out with due season. Due season is not when all the bills are due. Come on now. Due season, the Bible says, be not weary in well doing, for in due season ye shall reap if faint. Now watch this. He gives power to the faint. We have no excuse. We have power. That's your weakest moment. You ought to be looking for power. Come on now. See, that's why you have to say, the Bible says, let the weak say, I'm strong. Not just talking about weak in your body. Weak in whatever. Have a weak marriage, have a weak mind, have weak finances. See, are you following this? Now watch this. This is good right here. Woe to thee, O land, when your king is a child and your prince is eating in the morning. Blessed. We went from woe to blessed. Talking about your land. Talking about what God, your portion that God has for you. That he wants to give you power to go in and get. Woe to thee, O land, when your king is a child and your prince is eating in the morning. Blessed are you, O land, when your king is the son of nobles and your prince is eating due season for strength and not just to consume it upon their flesh for drunkenness. Here again, we're talking about over here. You're sitting there. You're not over here now with bellied up. Well, I finally made it. Woo, it's good. Yeah, y'all learn how to do it. It's good over here. No, you're over here, and you're over here to be strength. You know, Jesus told Peter, when you are converted, when you make your turnaround, strengthen your brethren. My goodness, they were bringing money and throwing it at Peter's feet. Come on now. Are you seeing this? This is not so you can get over here and just kick back and, hey, there's a responsibility over here. This is the place where can God trust you? This is a place where I'm in that nice place that you all have provided, this ministry has provided for us, and I just want to take a nap, but because of my commitment to God, I can't go to sleep. I have to get up out of there. I could just be kicking back. I have money in my pocket. I know how this thing works. Y'all figure it out. No. Good God Almighty. There's a reason for what you're doing. Now, certainly, he gives us richly all things to enjoy. I'm enjoying where I'm at. But there's a divine assignment that includes his family. So, you know, not to. When somebody's operating in drunkenness, it simply means that they can't think in their right mind. People get drunk on their wealth. They get drunk off power. They get drunk off greed. And they might be a strict, I don't drink any alcohol. But they're drunk off. You see that? Now watch this. Woe to thee, O land, when your king is a child and your prince is eating the morning. Blessed are you, O land, when your king is a son of nobles and your prince is eating due season for strength and not for drunkenness, by much slothfulness. Well, where's this come from? He's talking about those that are just kicked back, doing whatever. A child, supposed to be a king. Come on now. By much slothfulness, the building decays, and through idleness of hands, the house drops through. All of a sudden, because you're not moving in to responsibility, things begin to drop through. Marriage falls apart, drops through. That business deal dropped through. This dropped through, that dropped through. Come on now. Why? By much slothfulness. Why? What would, see, not y'all, but Christians, a lot of them are lazy. I can prove it. All you have to do is look at the turnout at election time. The Bible tells us that we are supposed to choose life. We are the highest voting block in the nation. We should be able to vote men of God, women of God in all the offices wherever we at. But Christians are lazy. They fighting among themselves. Oh, see, I can feel a little nerve in here, a little nerve right there. I ain't scared of you. No, seriously. We have the biggest voting block in the nation. But Christians, look at the turnout. Look at the turnout. We could, my goodness, are you kidding me? That's how lazy Christians. I'm talking about, you gotta, and it's law that they have to give you time off to go vote. Some places give you 4 hours off work. Some places they give you the whole day to go vote. But no! And this business about, well, I would never tell you who to vote for. That's between you and God. No, it ain't between you and God. It's between you and the book. Here's God right here. He said, choose life. Anybody that's up there contradicting what God says, you don't vote for them. They make no difference. Make no difference what color they are, what age they are, what party they are. Don't make no difference. What does this boy right here? We just turned Kentucky Christians. Man, y'all don't understand Kentucky up there, man. I tell you, you talk about devils in the government. I've been living there. We're in the capital city. Come on now, we're in the capital city, and I'm telling you what, one devil after another devil after another devil, and you sitting there just, my goodness. But we had a Christian man get up and wouldn't run off all these political issues. He ran off his Christian faith. He said, I'm a Christian. I have Christian morals. And this is what I'll do when I get in office. And all the polls had him behind going in the night before. And they said the only way he has a chance of winning is if the Christians go out and vote. And they went out and vote. Now we got a Christian governor. Come on now. With a Christian lieutenant governor. Hey, this governor, he got 9 kids. 4 of them black that he adopted from Ethiopia. His lieutenant governor is the first black woman ever to hold any office. She's a Christian. I don't care what the color is. I'm going to vote life. And Christians. Come on now. And now watch this. Watch this. It don't make no difference as far as the blessing going to stop me from doing what God has called me to do. And you understand what I'm saying? But He does make some things a little sweeter. Come on now. When you got somebody up there that's saying, hey, we need to pray over this thing here. Come on. Well, I don't know what all that is about. But there it is. How do we get all that out of that? I don't see none of that in there. Lazy Christians. That's what started that. Slothfulness, lazy Christians. Come on, folks. We can turn St. Petersburg around. We can turn Florida around. We can turn this nation around. One nation under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all. Somebody shout or something. Anyways, we get right by much slothfulness, the building decays, and through idleness of the hands, the house drops through. And here comes a feast. A feast is made for laughter, and wine makes merry. But money answers all things. Now watch this. Remember when the Bible gives us that parable about the father made a marriage and a feast, right? Remember that? And he sent out what? Servants to invite. There was an invitation given. And he walked out there, got all this table spread. Where is everybody? Watch this. They didn't answer the invitation. A feast is made for laughter. In other words, God's got all this table laid out. And nobody's answering the invite. Now watch this. But then he throws this in. But money answers. I mean, talking about just picking up the tab. Money responds to where it's invited. Money responds to where it's been welcomed. Money answers. You know, all right, let me paint a picture for you. Alberta, you know, we got this big old house we live in, just me and Alberta and our little puppy dog, Simon. 5,500 square feet. 5 bathrooms in it. You know, three levels. And, you know, it's nice. It's nice. And Alberta, she'll come up to me and she'll say, "Why ain't you been answering me?" Whoa, time out. Where are you? I've been calling you and you haven't been answering me. I'm going to take you somewhere here. Hon, whoa. I haven't been ignoring you. I didn't. Because if I'd have heard you, I would have. Money. Answers every time it's been invited. But the key is it has to come from the son of a noble. It has to come from a king that's not slothful. I'm giving you some stuff here. Apostle Thompson, with money cometh. He got a hold of that truth that money will respond. And Christians everywhere were going, "Money coming, they ain't getting no money." They wasn't getting no money. You know why they wasn't getting no money? Was he teaching right? Absolutely he was teaching right. But they were still a child. And a lazy child at that. All they thinking about is laying drunk somewhere. But money answers when it's invited, when it's welcome, when it's called by the proper kingly voice. Somebody My God. Well, it's strange to you when you first start doing this. You mean money hears me? Yep. I don't see no ears on it. The Bible says, because that's our main ingredient, that all of creation groans and travails, waiting on the manifestation of the what?
Son.
Of the what?
Son.
Sons of God. They're groaning. Your land is calling out to you. Are you calling out to it? Your car is calling out to you. Are you calling out to you? Oh, yes, Brother Philip, I've been doing that. Man. Yeah, but you cussing your neighbor out. Got to grow up in this thing. Sugar. Sweet thing. Jesus said this. When the people were praising him, they come out and said, "Stop them people from praising." He said, "Look, if they don't praise me, the rocks." What? I ain't never seen no rock make no noise. You know, as far as singing, whatever, rock and roll. But there's a sound. Little Simon. We'll go out at nighttime. His little ears perk up. Some of them hard to see. I don't see nothing. But I can see his little ears. He's hearing something that I ain't hearing. And so I know by spending so much time with him that he's been accurate 100% of the time. He's hearing in a dimension that I can't hear. Jesus kept saying, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. And all them folk he was talking to had ears. But not everybody was hearing. Folks, all of creation responds to sound. Money included. Money goes where it's been invited. With a kingly invitation. My God. And when a king summons its subject, he don't sit there and say, I ain't coming. No, you coming. Folks, I'm telling you, you got to be speaking to money. Money. M-O-N-E-Y, money. And you have to speak out of a kingly, matured, sonship, daughtership, not slothful, not drunk, voice, and invite money to you. That's ingredient number two. That's good right there.
That's good.
Well, this thing's just too hard. No, no, no. You see, we just hit your lazy bone. See, it's going to take some studying. It's going to take some diligence. It's going to take some obedience. But I'll tell you what's hard is living right over here. I ain't going back. Robert, I ain't going back. Never. Money, are you ready for this? Likes me. Well, I'm getting some strange looks right there. Because I treat it right. What's holy goes to God. What I've vowed to do, I put them out there. Where my partnerships are, I release that. Money likes that because money likes peace. It likes advancing the kingdom. It likes to do what it's designed to do. Money likes to get into my possession. Does it like to get in your possession? See, money's nothing more than a tool. Have you ever seen somebody that didn't take care of their tools? Man, my daddy, I'll tell you what. My daddy, if we leave a hammer outside in the yard and then it rained, are you kidding me? Because didn't take care of the tools properly, the tools don't work right. Is anybody hearing? Money wants to get where it's supposed to get. It doesn't like being in a drug deal. It doesn't like being sold, used for prostitution. It doesn't like all the sinful things that it's being used to do. Money don't like that. It goes against what God created, silver and gold. We're not talking about paper. We're talking about. Right? And it's crying out to answer. Feast is made for laughter. Wine makes merry. So you can have a feast and throw a party and not everybody show up. But money? Money show up every time. Well, I tried that and the deadline came and went. Look. We're talking about you growing up in this thing. And I can't explain. I don't know what you're doing. I've walked this walk. I know when our deadline came and went. And I shared that here before where the Lord said to me, what are you concerned about the deadline? Get hooked up to the lifeline. Come on now. But ingredient number two. I'm going around the mountain. I'm way past hungry now. No, are y'all getting this?
Yes.
Money, when invited with the proper tongue, answers all. Look what it says here. It says answers all. Things is italicized. So you and I are all. Money answers all. Answers the black person, the white person, the red person, the yellow person, the brown person, the old person, young person, whatever, rich person, poor person, money will answer all. But it has to be that kingly voice. I tell you what, that's good right there now. Blessed are your ears to hear that right there. That's ingredient number two, right? And I'm saving ingredient three and four, a night of peace. All right? You guys all right with that? You going to let me go eat for strength and not for drunkenness? Amen, Pastor Jonathan.
Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for that word tonight. We receive it with thanksgiving. Thank you for the man of God. We do pray for strength, for him to be replenished and restored, renewed and rejuvenated tonight. Father, we thank you that each and every one of us who's received the word tonight, we take it to heart and we will apply that which we learn. We grow up, Lord. You said the heir, as long as you're a child, differs nothing from a slave. Thank you that we're growing up to be able to receive as sons our inheritance that belongs to us, our portion. And we call money to us. It comes, it obeys, it runs to us in abundance. We thank you that we're learning, Lord. We will continue to receive. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Come on, give God a great hand of praise tonight.